All right, let's look at benzene side chain reactions. So most reactions on a benzene substituent are going to be identical to their respective reactions elsewhere that we've studied, whether it's alkene reactions or whatnot. But the proximity of the aromatic system does change reactivity in some cases, and so we want to look at a few of those. Some are the same, some are going to be a little bit different. Here's some common ways that we can exploit the substituents on a benzene for reactivity. All right, so I've got this rather nasty looking benzene derivative here. To show the difference in these what are called decarbonylation reactions, means removal of the carbonyl from not just benzene, but any compound. And we have here, if we were to take off these groups, all three of these reactions would do the same thing. So the first reaction here is the Wolff-Kishner, and it's going to remove that carbonyl to form that primary alkyl substituted benzene. Catalytic reduction is one of our reactions that does change when the carbonyl is right next to benzene. Instead of forming an alcohol and needing rainy nickel to do this reduction, it forms just the alkyl group, removes the carbonyl. Also, we have the Mazingo reaction, where we make a thioacetal in step one, and then in step two, the thioacetal is reduced and removed entirely and replaced with hydrogen. So a substitution type reaction there for that thioacetal. We get the same thing. These primary alkyl substituted benzenes, it's good to have a way to get to those because, as we talked about before, the Friedel-Crafts alkylation would cause a rearrangement. In this particular one, to an isopropyl benzene. Okay, so it would rearrange in the process of reaction. So Wolff-Kishner, all three of these are going to avoid that occurring. So the way we would get there is we would form this substituted benzene, the acyl substituted benzene, by doing the Friedel-Crafts acylation instead, aqueous workup to remove the Lewis acid, and we get our carbonyl substituted benzene there, our keto benzene. Now, from there, we do the Wolff-Kishner, one of these three reactions, to remove the carbonyl. Well, suppose these other groups are in place, and they're there because they pose a particular difficulty for the other two ways. Silyl ethers, so this is the protection, so TMS here stands for trimethyl silyl, they are unstable to acid. And so an acidic conditions with the Mazingo could potentially cause that TMS group to be removed. And catalytic hydrogenation with either palladium on carbon or rainy nickel would cause a problem where this alkene group would be reduced. But with our Wolff-Kishner, they're, both of those functional groups are rock stable to base, and so we maintain those two groups throughout the reaction. So this is a little chemoselectivity practice here with three different ways of accomplishing the same thing. But in the presence of other functional groups, you can have complications, okay? So making sure that we note that here as why we have different options for this process. All right, moving on. Another way we can make these carbon-carbon bonds to benzene is with coupling reactions. So we can make our bromo and chloro benzenes from halogenation of benzene with iron 3 bromide catalyst, or iron 3 chloride for that matter, and we can react benzyl halides here with, or halobenzenes with our alkyl borane. So with the Suzuki, we can make an alkyl borane that is either primary alkyl, we can use a alkenyl borane, so that would look something like this. Transalkenyls are our option there. And we can also do, leave that there, alkenyl. And we can also do an aryl borane. So the aeroborane is made from bromobenzene, treating it with lithium first to make the aerolithium, and then reaction with a trialkoxy borane would form this reagent, which can be used to couple to an alkyl or an alkenyl halide. Okay, so these halides that can be coupled to the coupling partner, aryl is one possibility, but any sp2 whether it's cis or trans can be coupled to Suzuki reagents. Okay, so again, review our alkyl our organometallic reactions video for the full treatment of those. But for these reactions that we just drew, again, we can make the aryl borane from the second reaction, but we can also make a primary alkyl substituted benzene, four carbons there from the alkyl borane. Okay, so same thing, no rearrangement. We do it with a coupling reaction instead. All right, well, Gilman's also a possibility for coupling. Gilman reagents can couple to aryl bromides. They can couple to primary alkyl. They can couple to alkenyl bromides and chlorides. Okay, so again, or iodides for that matter. So they can couple to all three of those. We get the same product here with our Gilman coupling as we did with Suzuki. One, two, three, four carbons in that group. And we could do primary alkyl with our Gilman reagent like we see here. We can do alkenyl. Or we can make an aryl Gilman reagent like we see the recipe for below, with an excess of that bromide or two equivalents of that bromide, we'd be our aryl bromide there, we'd be able to get our Gilman reagent to use with its coupling partner. Okay, another way to do that. All right, so let's look at halogenation. So typically we have best results with tertiary halides, we said before, but when benzene's involved, it increases the reactivity of this benzyl position. So the carbon right next to a benzene is a benzyl position, and that benzyl position is highly susceptible to bromination. In fact, we're going to see nearly quantitative 100% yield of this benzyl brominated reaction product. Okay, so we don't need NBS and peroxide and heat, but we can use NBS, peroxide, and heat to make the exact same compound. We can think of this as allylic. Benzylic is like allylic in that it's next door to an sp2 system. So we just substitute a hydrogen for a bromine radical, bromination, benzylic bromination here, like allylic from our radical studies. Well, once we've got a halide in that position, SN2 and E2 works the same as before. This is just review with a secondary halide like we have here. Could be a tertiary, could be a primary. So we have different rules for when, in a chart that guides us through SN2, E2 like we studied before. But with a secondary halide with a good nucleophile and a weak base, we're going to see SN2 as the major product. And so here's a good way to make an ester. Use a carboxylate as a nucleophile. It's a good nucleophile, weak base. pKa less than 15 on those weak bases. Good nucleophiles, we have a list that we learned back with substitution elimination. So we get our substitution there. Well, if we have a good nucleophile or a poor nucleophile and a strong base with a secondary halide, we're going to have elimination to the Zaitsev product be our number one reaction path in that situation. To make that yield a little better, benzene tends to favor elimination anyway, but we could make that into a methoxide to ensure that at least we're bulky enough to really suppress SN2 there, T-butoxide as well. All right, suppose we have reductions here with catalytic hydrogenation. Alkenes, carbonyls, and nitro groups are all going to be reduced with palladium on carbon reduction, hydrogen atmosphere. So this is a little bit different. Benzaldehyde would reduce straight to toluene, okay? If it was just a normal ketone, we would require hydrogen and rainy nickel, ketone or aldehyde for that matter, and it would make an alcohol product. And instead here with benzenes, it's super reactive, goes all the way to an alkyl group, all right? Palladium on carbon does the same as we're used to with alkenes attached directly to the benzene. Anything off the benzene follows that's more than one carbon away, not on that benzylic position, would reduce as we're used to seeing it from before. Nitro groups are also reduced to anilines. Okay, so nomenclature, here's benzaldehyde, here's styrene, here's nitrobenzene, and then we are reduced to toluene, ethylbenzene, and aniline as our products here. Okay, looking at nitriles, we need rainy nickel still. They're less reactive than our typical groups, so we still stick with rainy nickel here. What do we get? We get a primary amine from that nitrile. Get a CH2 from the carbon side, get an NH2 from the nitrogen side. Benzene itself can be reduced, so this isn't a side chain reaction. We'll throw this in here, but only under extreme conditions. So we've got high temperature and 25 atmospheres. Typically, a lot of these hydrogenations are done at elevated atmospheres of hydrogen. This is just one recipe that gets it done. Nickel, zero catalyst there, low valent nickel. Shiny stuff, powder form probably gets this done to reduce to a cyclohexane. Okay, but extreme conditions, lots of ways to do some of these reductions. We're just giving you one way for our purposes here. Okay, what if we're doing oxidation? So here's a complicated looking thing here. So I did this to just illustrate what happens if it's a methyl, if it's a primary, if it's a secondary, or if it's a methyl group. You know, if we're ignoring, we'll go ahead and call this a primary, since one other carbon, it's a methyl, it's still a methyl. Here though, it approximates a secondary position. Here it approximates a tertiary. Here it approximates a quaternary position attached to benzene. So there are no hydrogens on this last one, the quaternary, all right? Anything with a hydrogen allows the oxidation to proceed all the way to a carboxylic acid. And it clips off any additional hydrogens that may be present. Okay, so this extra hydrogen here, here, and here, they're all clipped off, replaced by a carboxylic acid where the carbon that's directly attached in that benzylic position is located. There are no hydrogens, then there's no oxidation that will occur. But chromic acids, very reactive and non-selective with alkyl groups on benzene. So you got to be careful when you use it. If we want a milder reagent that's not going to affect, we can even draw in a methyl down here, that's not going to affect our other groups, well, we can use bleach, we can use a sodium hypochlorite, that is, we can use PCC, we can use Swern oxidation to do a mild oxidation like we would normally expect for a benzene compound. Okay, so general overview, more reactions out there, but this is a good overview of things we can do to the benzylic position, things that stay the same, things that change.